Avenue J.
Okay, good evening, everyone. Thank you for coming. Got a great lecture tonight, Dona Gracia Nasi, fascinating individual. Doing the research on this individual just blew my mind. I read another book, another biography that was absolutely fascinating, and I feel that this is one of those tremendously underreported histories of, so this is one of those tremendously underreported heroines of Jewish history that makes such a phenomenal difference to our self-understanding and in fact our continued existence, as we shall see, and I hope that I'll be able to convey some of that to you over the course of the next 60 minutes. She is affectionately known by many Sephardim as La Señora, as the Lady, because of her phenomenally important work on behalf of the Jewish people, her heroism, her unstinting willingness to stand up for what is right, despite tremendous, really regal odds against her, as we shall see. In Hebrew, she's often known as Hagiveret, the translation of La Signora, meaning the lady, and we'll explore that. This picture is most likely nothing like what she looked like. It's a modern artistic representation, but we do have a sense of what she might have looked at like from a slide that I'll show you at the very end. But nevertheless, her personality was incredibly appealing and attractive, and that's really what we're going to be concentrating on today. Here we go. We'll be relying very heavily on her two principal biographers in English, Cecil Roth, the great interwar scholar and post-World War II scholar of Jewish history, who wrote an extremely important biography, and the book that I just read for tonight's lecture, André Elion Brooks, who wrote a fascinating account called The Woman Who Defied Kings, which is in fact a very accurate term to use to describe Gracia Nasi, using a lot of more current research, archival materials that have become available in the almost 80 years since Professor Roth wrote his book. So we're very heavily indebted to the research of these two scholars for tonight's presentation. So let's start with her name. What shall we call her? This is an extremely complicated subject. So at her christening, obviously we're speaking about a woman who is a converso, a woman who lived a double life, posing as a Christian in inquisitorial Portugal and later on through Europe. So she led a dual existence, posing as a Christian while secretly holding Jewish attitudes and behaviors. So at her christening, she received the name Beatrice de Luna Mendes. Beatrice is a name she never used in any formal sense. De Luna was one of her ancestral names. In Hispanic culture, it's very common for women to take both their mother's and their father's names, and it probably alludes to the family background in Aragon, which is a region of Spain. Miquez is also an interesting name. Both of these, by the way, were probably given to them by sponsors, because when a Jew was baptized as part of the often or mostly sham conversions that they underwent during these difficult times, they would be accompanied by a sponsor, typically a member of the royal family or a nobleman or something like that, and then the Jew now converted to a Christian would take on the name of their sponsor, a kind of a godfather-like figure. Hence you have so many Jews with the name Nunez, Mendez, Rodriguez. These are all names of important Spanish royalty of the 15th century in particular. So the name de Luna is probably from a sponsor on one side of her family. The name Miquez is kind of interesting because she actually had one family member, the name repeats itself several times in the family. He preferred to use it because it alluded to his date of birth, which occurred right around this time of year, Parshas Miketz. So he enjoyed calling himself Miketz as a result. She preferred, however, to use the name Gracia, which is a diminutive of Beatrice. Beatrice, however, is a Latin term originally, which means saintly one. Beatus means saintly in a Christian sense. She never liked using that term. She preferred using the term Gracia, which may have been a translation of her Hebrew name, Chana. this is, to me, it struck me in a very personal way because, of course, you know, I also have two names. Like many Jews, I have my Hebrew name, and I have what I like to call my slave name, right? Henry is my regular secular name that my parents gave me, and Hillel is also my Hebrew name that my parents gave me as well. But Henry is what I use when I try to pass in the street as a regular American. Not too successfully, I think. But, you know, this whole dual identity and the whole dual naming is something that probably dates really from the Spanish Inquisition. I'm hard-pressed to think of Jews having secular names prior to the 1500s. It's a very, very common phenomenon, however, and in Hispanic, among Hispanic Jews, often the names are totally different. I mean, in English, Henry and Hillel at least begin with the same letter, but in Spanish you can have completely wildly different names. At any rate, Gracia, she may have chosen that as a translation for her name, Hannah. Her surname, through her husband, who was also her uncle. This is a very common characteristic of converso families, is that they are highly endogamous, always marrying within the same converso family. So in other words, even though they may have lived as Christians for 3, 4, 5 generations, they're still marrying other Jews who are similarly living as Christians. So she married her uncle, which quite a bit older than she, which is typical, which is actually considered ideal in some Talmudic texts. It's not consanguinity. Is that a real word? Consanguinity, being marrying someone too close to you in relations. His name was Mendes, also known as Benvenista, also a very common surname that is used by many Sephardic Jews today. I actually know some Benvenistas who claim descent from the house of Nasi all the way to the present day in South Florida. So, bottom line, she preferred to go by Gracia Nasi. Nasi is one more name to add to the whole mix. This is a family name. It's a Hebrew word that means prince, as in Yehuda HaNasi, indicating a royal lineage, or at least a lineage of leadership. And this is how she allowed herself to be known most commonly. But all of these names really apply to the same person. Confusing, complicated, but we're going to stick with Gracia Nasi in particular. What I find most fascinating about her life is that it's so illustrative of the liminal existence of the converso. We're talking about a person who is really living in two worlds. It's not that once a Jew converted to Christianity, especially under duress, that they could simply adopt this new identity. Because as we shall see and explore over the next 20 minutes or so, the Spanish Inquisition was specifically designed to root out those conversions to Christianity which were not sincere. And so even though these conversos had actually adopted a new faith, they were always being tested in that new faith. And the smallest little deviance from what was considered acceptable behavior could be grounds for incredible persecution, confiscation of their wealth, torture, and even execution. And this is a curse that they lived with for generations. Fear of being discovered as a crypto-Jew, or even the fear of being denounced as a crypto-Jew when it was not at all the case, was something that plagued conversos for many generations, even those who may have wished to become complete and enthusiastic, authentic Christians. They always had to live under the shadow of suspicion. This is a rather interesting depiction of two converso Jews who have been accused of Judaizing, that is, of going back on their Christian vows and practicing Jewish rites. They're both wearing this ritual garment that was part of the Inquisition when they were taken to task for their behaviors. The figure on the right here has a little caption in French that says, this refers to a man, a Jew, who is condemned to the fire, but he has acquitted himself through his confession, meaning he has, admitted, yes, it's true, I love bagels and lox, and I eat them every Sunday morning, whatever, things like that. And as a result, he is, he's going to the flames, but with a clean heart. They would also give them the benefit of strangulation prior to their burning so that they could, die a somewhat less brutal death. This figure on the right is saying, I refuse to confess my sins. I am actually a good Christian. I just like bagels. And the French says, a person who will be burned by the decree of the Inquisition. You can see he's quite a bit sadder because he feels is tremendously unjust. But in both cases, we're talking about Jews who are forcibly converted to Christianity, and whether they confess or whether they don't confess, whether they regret or they don't regret, they are still bound by these Kafkaesque rules of the Inquisition to meet a horrible fate. We'd like to say a few words about the experience of Iberian Jewry, including primarily Spain and Portugal, obviously, because today's lecture and the next two lectures are really going to borrow heavily from this experience. We should consider the fact that in the 15th century, the destruction of Iberian Jewry was a colossal event that can be compared only to the Holocaust in our times. Spain was a country that had housed the Jews for centuries, had given them a phenomenal golden age, had been the home of Yehuda Halevi, diplomats like Chastai ibn Shaprut, scholars like Shmuel Hanagrela, scholars like Maimonides, it's true, who fled from Muslim persecution in the region, but nevertheless, Spain was like America, Lahavdil. Spain was a tremendous home for the Jews for centuries upon centuries. And the rupture of Jewish continuity in this peninsula was overwhelming. And in fact, took Sephardic Jews centuries to get over it, and maybe they haven't even gotten over it until today. To be sure, the next 100 years, Jews are obsessed with the idea of how could Spain fall and what it meant for the unfolding of the Messianic period. So we really can't minimize the impact of the end of Iberian Jewry on the Jewish consciousness. Here's a map that gives you a sense of the diaspora of Sephardic Jews, that is, Jews from Spain. We're specifically going to be looking at the Jews who were expelled from Spain around 1492, or some had left a little earlier, and then went to Portugal over here, where our heroine is born. She lived most of her life in Lisbon. Later, I'll show you a map that shows how she fled Lisbon and made her way, like many of the expellees, up to England, and then to the Low Countries, down through Italy, and ultimately to Constantinople over here, Istanbul. The influence of Spanish exiles and Portuguese exiles throughout the entire Mediterranean basin had a telling impact on the future development of Jewish intellectual and creative thought for centuries. So let's look at the collapse of Spanish Jewry and understand a little bit of the roots of the Inquisition. As I mentioned, Spain went through several centuries of phenomenal acclaim. Jews reached the highest levels of cultural activity, their scholarship, their political activity. They had, they were really the leaders, like in America in many ways, the leaders of all cultural activity, of publications, poetry, literature. We had a Jew who was the head of the army in one region of Spain for a while, an incredible amount of achievements. It all came crashing to a halt, in particular in 1391, when there was a tremendous backlash after a few years after the death of one of the greater of the Jewish political figures in Spain, and there was a widespread pogrom that raged through Cordoba. This is the Alhambra Mosque I'm sorry, the Alhambra Palace, which was possibly built by Jews, but is perhaps one of the great landmarks of Spanish Cordoba. Following the 1391 pogrom, which was quite significant, there was more and more Christian influence coming down into Spain, and one of the attributes of the Iberian Peninsula in the Christian context is that since it is not only on the borderland both geographically, it's also on the borderland religiously as well. Spain for many years toyed with different forms of Christianity. Arianism in particular was a rival to the Catholic interpretation of the faith that was ultimately ousted in the 4th century. And of course, Spain was Muslim after the 8th century. So it was always kind of like it had the zeal of a convert, if I can say that about an entire peninsula. The Spaniards in particular were often trying to demonstrate their Catholic bona fides. And one of the best ways to demonstrate that you were in fact true to the faith was by persecuting the Jews. So Spain had once it became Christian again, it had a very, very strong anti-Jewish streak that appeared over and over again. In our context, perhaps the most significant are the history of disputations which raged throughout Spain. 1263 is perhaps the one you're most familiar with. That's when the great scholar Nachmanides was called to debate a Jewish Catholic convert, Jewish convert to Catholicism named Pablo de Cristiani. Nachmanides ended up winning that debate. He officially lost, but then he was banished immediately thereafter because he had shown up his interlocutor. And then a much more of a horrific example in 1414 in the city of Tortosa, which Jane Gerber, a scholar of this period, has called more of a pageant than a disputation, where 2,000 guests were assembled in order to witness the ritual humiliation of the Jewish interpretation of the Bible. So there was just more and more events that were culminating, indicating that Spain was no longer a hospitable environment for Jews. It culminates in 1479 with the establishment of the Inquisition. Now, what exactly is the Inquisition? This is a key point that we have to bear in mind. In Spain, in the 15th century, there were a tremendous number of forced conversions of Jews to Christianity. Many Jews, feeling the threat of immediate violent harm, had acceded to the demands of their persecutors and had taken on baptism. This was an issue we talked about a couple of weeks ago when we looked at the Ashkenazic lands and how many Jews there chose to actually commit suicide, murdering their own children before they killed themselves. Horrific examples. In Spain, many Jews chose the route of pretending to be Christian and hoping that things would eventually die down. And this lasted for close to a century. And so when you get towards the end of the 15th century, you've got all these Christians of Jewish origin who are sort of waiting and waiting to go back to Judaism. They're hoping that the political climate will change, that it'll have a new king or things like that, and things will calm down. This incensed the church and those zealous elements within Spain, and so they appointed Thomas de Torquemada, who is reputed to have some Jewish origins himself, as the Grand Inquisitor. And the Inquisition was designed specifically to root out those new Christians, so-called new Christians, who may have been two or three generations Christian, who were secretly practicing Jewish rites. Note that, technically speaking, Jews who never converted to Christianity were exempt from the reach of the Inquisition. The Inquisition was directed at Christians who were Judaizers. Jews who were Judaizers were technically exempt. They would not be exempt from the expulsion a little bit later, but the Inquisition was directed specifically at these new Christians. And the Inquisition used the most horrific means possible to exact the information they needed. It was almost Stalinist in its scope. Stalinist in its scope, where Jews would be, or new Christians, excuse me, would be arrested, and then they would be routinely tortured in order to exact confessions of their Judaizing practice, and even more importantly, to betray others in the Jewish community, or in the, excuse me, the new Christian community who had also similarly Judaized. And in the twisted logic of this time, because they may have actually been innocent, they may have actually been Christian, and it was forbidden to shed the blood of a fellow Christian, torture methods were used only if they did not pierce the skin. And so a whole range of devices were employed to try to coerce confessions out of these new Christians, typically involving hanging, stretching, a form of waterboarding, some really strange devices like this one, which involves an extremely uncomfortable positions for long periods of time. And not surprisingly, as we saw in the 1930s in Stalinist Russia, that people would give up all kinds of names. They would say anything under torture, and so then those people who were betrayed, who may have been innocent, would then be brought in, would also be tortured, and this expanded far out of control. In fact, it went way past the new Christian community and even attacked Christians with impeccable credentials. The Bishop of Toledo, for example, was also drawn into the net of Torquemada's excesses, and hence the Spanish Inquisition became proverbial as a purge-like witch hunt that goes on and on for centuries. The Jews would be, or the new Christians, excuse me, I keep on making that mistake, they would be brought before a public tribunal. Here you can see them wearing these hats of shame, these long conical hats, which may have had association with the later witches' hats and the dunce caps, where they would be, they would be forced to either recant their ways, which would guarantee them a death by strangulation and then by burning, or if they refuse to recant, then they would simply be thrown alive into the fire, which is the, of course, the auto da fe, the acts of faith, so called by the church at the time. So that's the sort of mechanism of the Inquisition. I reiterate that it's directed primarily at these new Christians, and not at Jews per se. Let's also talk a little bit about terminology before I go on. I'm just going to move away from this awful slide before we do. The terminology is complex. You may have heard the term Marano, which is perhaps the most common term. And many historians have tried to find fanciful derivations for this term from medieval Latin and so on. In reality, it's simply derived from an old Spanish word meaning pig. And this was a term used, a term of opprobrium used to describe these Jews who had become Christian and then were, so to speak, returning to their old ways, like, as the church would have it, a dog returning to its vomit. So the term Marano is not exactly politically correct, even though it was overwhelmingly popular, even among Jews themselves. Another term that might be more appropriate is converso. These are Jews who had converted, or crypto-Jews, that is, Jews who were hiding their Jewish identity. And let us bear in mind that, you know, the very tenuous nature of what could expose a person to a charge of Judaizing. For example, the smallest kind of deviation from group standards was highly scrutinized by those who wish to denounce a new Christian. For example, the habit of many converso families of eating a kind of fried sausage, a fried and breaded sausage, but replacing the sausage, pork sausage, with partridge meat or chicken would immediately expose a family to the risk of Judaizing. So the very diet of a Jew was considered very suspect. Of course, if Jews didn't show up for regular mass, if they had unusually large and frequent gatherings in their homes, all kinds of things like this would point a finger of suspicion that would linger for decades and decades. And we should not also recall, we should also recall that there was a very strong economic motive to denounce these Jews. The property of convicted Judaizers was confiscated and distributed to the church, and invariably rewards were given to people who had denounced them. So as a result, there was actually an incentive for people to rat out their neighbors and tell the church that they were in fact Judaizing, which just like in the Stalinist example, it made it grow larger and larger. So this was essentially the condition of Jews in Spain specifically for much of the 15th century. It ended horribly in 1492 with this document, which of course is the decree of expulsion that was signed by Ferdinand and Isabella, demanding that Jews pack up and within a few months' time leave the country of Spain where they had resided for some 900 years. Terrible experience that left such a huge scar on the Jewish mind. Okay, that brings us to Portugal. Okay, so let's go on. Now, Portugal's a little different. Portugal, as you know, is the country on the westernmost point of the Iberian Peninsula, and they did not have the same history of persecution that the Spaniards did. Many Jews, of course, in 1492 felt that the easiest route to take to flee Spain would be simply to go to neighboring Portugal, and in fact they resided there. However, the Portuguese realized that they would have a difficult time with their Spanish neighbor if they had a much more liberal policy. So they adopted a policy which was economically prudent, and that is they agreed to accept the Jewish refugees on the payment of very steep and temporary residence fee. Jews had to pay a rather astronomical fee to reside in Lisbon for any length of time, and there were fees for crossing certain bridges and fees for remaining in certain places and so on, and the Portuguese hoped to profit as much as possible from the situation. Things changed, however, within a very short period of time as King, now I wish I had written this down, there's a king, there's several of them actually in Spain, who's often referred to as King John in English literature, but in more modern scholarship, his Portuguese spelling is used, which is spelled J-O-A-O, right? And my daughter, who's fluent in Spanish, not Portuguese, I was trying to figure out with her, how do you say that? J-O. She thought it was like Joao. Could you imagine naming your son Joao?
I mean, say J, Spanish say.
So she actually said Jao. So anyways, I think I'm gonna go with John. But luckily for today, the only Portuguese king we're gonna talk about is Manuel, which is pronounced Frank. No, Manuel. So King Joao died, I think, in late 1495, and Manuel was a younger man who needed a bride. Ferdinand and Isabella had a daughter, also named Isabella, but she refused to marry the King of Portugal, which would have united the entire peninsula. She refused to marry the King of Portugal while Portugal housed Jews. So Manuel had a choice to make. Should he expunge all the Jewish presence in his land, which was economically not expedient at all? Portugal had a huge windfall by having the Jews come into their region because, after all, the Jews were incredibly experienced traders, very, very experienced in commerce, literate, and so on. And so he really wasn't sure what to do about this, but Isabella was quite fanatical about this. She would not marry him otherwise, and so he came up with a kind of a plan. The plan was essentially to forcibly convert the Jews of Portugal to Christianity, and then expel whatever was left. That way he was hoping to keep the population and their business acumen and their business connections and so on, and of course their wealth. Then a small number, he could simply expel them and he would win the favor of Isabella. And this is exactly the plan that he followed. With incredible cruelty, however, he began by looking at the economically weakest elements of the Jewish population, and he tore away some 700 children from their parents' arms and forced them to ship them off to the little island of Sao Tome. You can see over there on the equator, a relatively new possession of the Portuguese, who were at this time engaged in tremendous maritime activities. There it is. The 700 children who were sent there disappeared. It was assumed that the vast majority of them died. And according to a contemporary chronicler, many of them were actually devoured by the great lizards that lived on that island. I'm not sure if they actually have lizards that big there. Could be a fanciful.
That's a Komodo dragon which lives in the Komodo Islands of Japan.
It's actually, I looked at Komodo dragons, but this is a monitor lizard.
They're related.
Oh, they're related. Okay. Neither of them are Portuguese, though.
No, no.
But at any rate, I wanted a picture of a big lizard. I forgot there would be a professor of biology in the room. But at any rate, it's a sad story. 700 children taken to Sao Tome and then killed. The rest, under duress and under torture, were converted to Christianity. And as a result, Portugal now acquired a large converso population as well. However, Manuel was not stupid about this. This was purely a political ploy with economic overtures. And so he signed into the conversion agreements that the Jews would be free from investigation for 20 years after the forced conversion. In other words, he said, okay, you all have to pretend you're Christian, but we're not going to look too closely at you for 2 decades. And that way, the Jews, unhappy as they were, and it was definitely brutal and they were exposed to torture, nevertheless, they could more or less continue their lives as normal, more or less, under Portugal, with much greater freedom than they had enjoyed in Spain in the Inquisition there. There was no Inquisition in Portugal at this time, so there was no interference of the church demanding that they conform to Christian norms. And so initially, the Portuguese experience was really quite different from that of Spain. And it was in this environment that Dona Gracia was born, probably in the year 1510. That is some 15 years after the expulsion from Spain. She was married, as I mentioned earlier, she came from a very wealthy family. The Mendes family were very big into banking, into jewels, and they really capitalized very heavily on the huge maritime trade that Portugal was really opening up in the late 14th and early 15th century. Vasco da Gama, the great explorer, had already gone around the Horn of Africa and had discovered another route towards India. And so there was a tremendous amount of trade to be had by supplanting the old overland route for spices from the Orient and taking it by sea and offering it a much cheaper price to the expanding European markets. So there, the Mendes family were able to extend banking privileges to the Portuguese kings, loaning them sufficient funds to be able to mount these massive maritime exploits and then receiving their payment after the ships came in, so to speak, making the Mendes extremely wealthy and powerful and very closely related to the king. Like many converso families, she married within the larger converso community. And here you see a painting of her from the famous artist Arthur Zick, that shows Francisco here as somewhat younger than he probably was. He was twice her age when they married at 18. He was in his early 40s. But nevertheless, they enjoyed a brief but very happy marriage together that produced one child named Ana. Now, the problem is that the converso wealth that they had was both a promise. It gave them tremendous power at all times because they were able to leverage that wealth for policies that they promoted for the benefit of the Jewish community. They were extremely philanthropic and also quite involved in the realpolitik of offering bribes to make sure that the converso community may remain safe. But at the same time, their great wealth made them a target. And so they were constantly under attack by people who wish to point out their obvious failures to conform to Christian practice in the hopes that their wealth would be confiscated. And so one of the many things that Gracia and her husband, and later Gracia alone, had to do over and over again was constantly pay off bribes to ecclesiastic and temporal officials to gain exemptions and protections from the depredations of those who would denounce them. Let's have a look at one more kind of interesting thing that Arthur Zick put into this picture. You can see she's holding a scroll here, and when you look closely at the scroll, and want to guess what it says there? Famous verse? Right. Beautiful passage from the Book of Psalms. If I forget you, O Jerusalem, let my tongue cleave to my mouth, let my right hand use its cunning. Her proto-Zionism is very prominent. In fact, she would be a major figure in establishing a Jewish presence in Israel later on in her life. Yes,
Mr. Kuhlman.
Oh yeah, look at this little Jewish star. This is quite anachronistic. We Jews weren't using this as a symbol for Judaism back then, but nevertheless, really cool. Okay, so let's go on. They spent many years. She was married at age 18. She was widowed at age 25, making her the heir to a tremendous... Is that me? That's my microphone, right? She was heir to a tremendous fortune. Maybe if I hold it further away. Is that better? She was heir to a tremendous fortune, and once she was widowed at age 25, that made her incredibly powerful. Now, her husband had a brother named Diogo, who was living at this point in Antwerp, and in fact, she would join him later, and she would later inherit him as well. There's a whole family saga here that I'll share some details with you. But in 16th, 17th century Europe, widowhood was really one of the few ways that women could exert power in the world. Certainly on a small scale, but when you're dealing with a woman like Gracia, who was working with and sometimes in opposition to kings and queens and incredibly powerful individuals, popes, her widowhood was really what gave her her independence and her might, her ability to actually flex her muscles financially and achieve her will. They were acting in a clandestine fashion when they were married together in Lisbon, primarily to thwart the Inquisition, which eventually did make its way to Portugal, but they underwrote a lot of activities to try and prevent the church from extending the Inquisition there, including very liberal bribes and perhaps even some assassinations of inquisitorial officials. But the Inquisition was impossible to hold back. And you know, the smallest thing could set them off. So, for example, there was in the Jewish quarter of Lisbon, which was they still had like a Jewish quarter, a kind of a ghetto type of setup, but it was more like a what they would call in Boca Raton a gated community. There was a young Christian courtier who was seeking out a young Jewish woman that he had met in the marketplace earlier that day, and he went into a house hoping to find her, and he discovered a whole bunch of Jews gathered there around the table, and this happened to be Erev Pesach, the Passover Seder. And of course, these are new Christians, conversos. And of course, he came out and he proclaimed this in the streets, and it caused quite a hue and cry. Similarly, in another occasion, when there was a plague raging in the city, a whole bunch of new Christians and older Christians were gathered in a church, and they were praying for redemption from this plague, and the light shining through the windows in the back lit up a cross at one end of the room with an unusual luminescence. Many of the Christians in the room felt that this was a miraculous sign that in fact the plague was about to be lifted, and a converso, you can tell it's a kind of a Jewish approach, he scoffed at the idea that this trick of the light meant there was divine favor. This incensed the entire church population, and a riot ensued shortly thereafter. So you can see the kind of tinderbox that Lisbon was at this time as the Inquisition was approaching. So she decided to flee Lisbon and make her way to Antwerp, where her surviving brother-in-law was living and making business. Tremendous difficulty getting out of any of the places she tried to get out because, of course, her phenomenal wealth meant that the ruling authorities refused to allow her passage. On the one hand, they didn't want to insult her because they wanted to keep her wealth intact and keep her working for the benefit of the larger economy, and so they couldn't simply refuse her passage. She is allowed to travel, but on the other hand, if they allow her to travel, there's always the worry that she would not come back. And that is, in fact, what she did. She made her way up to London, where there was a kind of a secret underground railway for Maranos, for conversos who wanted to flee out of Spain and Portugal. And then from there, she went across the English Channel to Antwerp, where she met up with her brother. She brought with her a character that I have not mentioned yet, but someone who will be very important in her later life, her younger sister, Brianda, and Brianda, who would later marry Diogo, would eventually have a child. Her younger sister, as we shall see, did not share Gracia's attitude towards Judaism, and in fact this would have disastrous consequences for all of them. Later on, just to jump ahead of our story because we have this beautiful map here, she made her way down to the south of France, to Venice for a while, to Ferrara, where she was a very active, and she, most likely, it is in Ferrara where she finally renounced her Christian status and returned to Judaism, and eventually she made her way to Constantinople, where she most likely passed away. Constantinople at this time was, of course, ruled by the Ottoman Turks, who are Muslims, who were openly inviting Jews to come to Muslim lands and were laughing out loud in print and in all kinds of proclamations that the Christian persecution of Jews was in fact enriching the Ottoman territories. Very famous passages from various sultans to this effect. When she was in Ferrara in particular, recall at this point she met up with Diogo, and there's a lot of fascinating sort of behind the scenes negotiations over the will, the estate that belonged to her late husband and her brother. Ultimately, her brother-in-law ceded her complete control over the entire wealth of the house of Nasi, even over his own wife and daughter. He felt that she would be a much better a steward of that wealth than his wife, as we shall see, for good reason. So when she was in Ferrara, she was up until this point, they've been extremely generous in fundraising and in producing resources for Jews who are fleeing persecution, and actively promoting the rescue of conversos, in particular, from various persecutions and depredations at the hand of the church. In Ferrara, she's able to spend her money a little differently, and she becomes a great patron of Jewish scholarship. Two works in particular are associated with her activity. The first is work of Samuel Uske, a famous work which has been translated to English, The Consolations for the Tribulations of Israel, which is a sort of a historical and a philosophical work about the nature of Jewish persecution over the centuries. And then the famous Ferrara Bible, which is a translation of the Hebrew Tanakh into Judeo-Spanish, into Ladino. And this is, there's got a fascinating kind of cover on it. You can see that the frontispiece here has a depiction of a ship in a stormy sea with sea monsters and a broken mast. And it's an unusual kind of emblem to put on the front page of a Bible, the title page of the Bible. Anyone have any thoughts why she would choose to have it decorated so? This special Bible written in the spirit, really, of the age, with Luther publishing in German and so on, writing a Bible that conversos could read in a language that they were trained in, schooled in, and yet having this kind of image on the cover. What do you think about, like, the The experience of the Jews as a whole. Can you imagine these conversos traveling from place to place and trying to stay afloat, and yet, you know, the mast is broken and the winds are blowing. You know, I like the wind over here in the corner, and it's very dangerous, and nevertheless, they're making their way through the sea. I find it a very evocative and beautiful image myself. Okay, well, let's go on. I find that fascinating. We'll talk about it more another time. Now, at this point, family conflict. So let's recall that the way the wealth is managed up until this point, she has all the money from her husband, and Diogo, her brother-in-law in Antwerp, has the other half. That's largely because her husband felt that Diogo had assisted in producing that wealth, but in reality, it was her husband who made most of it. At any rate, when she gets to Antwerp, she becomes right away Diogo's right-hand person. Diogo ends up marrying her younger sister and having a child, who is known as La Chica. She's named Beatrice after her aunt, after Gracia. La Chica means the young one, and that's often used to distinguish her from her aunt. But it seems that her sister, younger sister, is really not enthusiastic about all the schlepping around and the secret converso culture stuff. She was really happy in Lisbon. She was happy living as a Christian. And all this, you know, living on a razor's edge, worried about what's going to happen to the family, what's going to happen to our money. Are you actually seriously talking about moving to Istanbul of all places? It didn't appeal to her at all. And she becomes more and more restive when it comes to the discussions that her husband and Gracia were having about the possibility of fleeing Europe altogether. Ultimately, after Diogo passes away, and in his will, as I mentioned earlier, he left all of the money in the control of Gracia, his sister-in-law, not his wife and his daughter. Gracia, the younger daughter, the younger sister, Brianda, would formally denounce her own sister to the church and claim that her sister, truthfully, her sister was secretly living as a Jew, and that she, therefore, Brianda, the younger sister, deserved all of the wealth of the family, and her sister should be arrested, possibly tortured, and killed, and so on. It was a really difficult point in Gracia's life, if you can imagine. This human conflict had reached such a fever pitch, but it was clear that there was no turning back between the two of them. The idea of fleeing Europe altogether and living in a Muslim country was something that was so foreign to Brianda's way of thinking. She had grown used to the life of heavy consumption that was associated with the uber wealthy of Europe, and she simply would have nothing of it. Gracia had anticipated this and had very liberally greased the palms of all kinds of church and temporal officials trying to hold back a formal lawsuit challenging her authority. She was not able to prevent a lawsuit from actually reaching the court, but she was ultimately able to defeat her sister in a legal battle and lay authoritative claim to the entire inheritance, which is a rather amazing feat. It just shows you how useful money is. On the other hand, in a related development, there was also a rabbinic court convened on this particular issue that included some of the greatest minds of the era. Don't forget, this is the 16th century. This is the era when you have Moshe Ditrani, for example, and you have none other than the Rav Yosef Karo, the author of the Code of Jewish Law, the Shulchan Aruch, who debated this very point, and ironically, the author of the Shulchan Aruch, Yosef Karo, disagreed with Gracia Mendes. Even though he felt that she was a wonderful person and they did great things for the Jewish people and so on, it wasn't right that the sister didn't get an inheritance and that the niece didn't get an inheritance either. But that's another story beyond what we're going to discuss here. Part of this whole debate was surrounding as well who would the younger child marry? Who would Beatrice La Chica end up marrying? And at this point, you know, I've kind of omitted discussion of the role of kings here, but there are tremendous involvement of kings and queens all having designs on the money of the House of Nasi. In this particular case, George V, the Holy Roman Emperor, had a wife who wanted to marry off La Chica to one of her closest friends, and in so doing, hoped to garner a large section of the assets that belonged to the Nasi family. When the queen approached Gracia Nasi about this, she actually avoided her several times by feigning illness, and when was finally forced to answer up front what would she say about this particular marriage of her niece to this older Christian man, Gracia Nasi said, intemperately, "I would rather see my niece drowned than married to that man." Very strong language, which meant that she really had to flee Europe because there was no more excuse for her at that point. So they ended up finally making their way to Istanbul. And at this point, Gracia Nasi had revealed her Jewish identity and was quite openly, actively sponsoring Jewish causes without any vacillation or dissimulation whatsoever. But she met with several setbacks. One that's very important is the Altona incident of 1556, which is perhaps the saddest moment in her career. There was an Italian city with a port called Ancona, and they had a very zealous inquisitor there sent by a new pope, Paul IV. And there was a very large converso community, and these are, again, remember, what are we talking about here? We would have in Ancona, we had the regular Jews, the Italian Jews who had lived there since time immemorial, who were not forced to convert to Christianity. You had regular Christians, and then you had this converso community, largely made up of Portuguese Jews, who were formally converted to Christianity and were in such confession, but were nevertheless living pretty much openly as Jews, marrying with each other, keeping kosher, and all kinds of things like this. They could not, you know, declare themselves openly to be Jewish, because that would be in contravention of church law. You can't simply convert to Christianity and then convert back again. But they were not prepared to live as Christians. So you had these three distinct populations in Ancona, as you did in many centers where Jews settled. The Pope and his very zealous inquisitor arrested approximately 100 of these conversos in Ancona and proceeded to take the traditional inquisitorial route of torturing them, extracting confessions, arresting others, and so on, and threatening to burn them. Gracia Mendes, of course, was incensed and wanted to do everything possible to prevent the abuse of her co-religionists, but she was unable to succeed. She actually went so far as to enlist the aid of the Sultan of Turkey, which she had that level of contact with, and the Sultan sent an emissary to Ancona to indicate that any sort of maltreatment of these conversos would result in potentially military action from the Ottoman Empire. Gracia also, you know, rounded up a huge number of Jewish communities who agreed to impose a boycott on the port of Ancona and to bring that city to its knees economically, because Jews were extremely involved in all kinds of international trade, and refusing to do business with that particular port would actually bring their trade to a standstill. Unfortunately, she was unable to achieve unanimity on the question of a boycott. There were a few holdouts, notably the Italian Jews of Ancona, who felt that they were being unfairly drawn into this international dispute. There was not always friendly relations between traditional Jews and conversos. They were living very, you know, distinct communities. Even though they had quite a bit of relations with each other, they were certainly not intermarrying and so on. So they felt that they were going to have their livelihoods destroyed by this boycott, and they argued against it, as did several local communities who were heavily dependent on the Ancona trade. And so despite her tremendous efforts, she was not able to bring together Jewry with one voice on this issue, and the boycott failed. And 100 Jews were put to death as a result of the inquisitorial flames. She, however, devoted most of the energies of the last years of her life to developing the land of Israel with some very fascinating projects. One of them, most famously, is the city of Tiberia or Tiberias, which she essentially bought from the Ottoman Turks. She received an exclusive grant in perpetuity to develop the city of Tiberias on the Sea of Galilee, in exchange, of course, for funds that would be produced and would be given to the Ottoman Turks on a regular basis. So the very city of Tiberia, which is modeled in many ways on the successful city of Tzfat nearby, is a result of Dona Gracia's specific intervention and her philanthropy. So if we want to bring it back to look at her legacy, this is perhaps our best chance of guessing what she actually looked like. This is a medallion that was struck in honor of her niece's 18th birthday. And you can see that it says in Hebrew, Gracia Nasi, on the Hebrew here, on her 18th birthday. This is the niece known as La Chica. So to whatever degree there is a family resemblance, that's the degree to which we can get a sense of how our heroine actually looked. The medallion was most likely struck on the occasion of her marriage to Don Joseph Nasi, also a family member. But the overall scope and trajectory we get of the life of this really phenomenal woman is one of unrelenting heroism and one of an indomitable will in which she's confronted with these very difficult challenges, the challenges of great wealth, the challenge of Jewish identity within a very hostile environment. And throughout it all, she maintains a very steadfast support of the Jewish people. She allows her burning love for Judaism to remain within her soul for the vast majority of her life while she is outwardly practicing as a Christian, and only when she is finally free to express herself as a Jew does she ultimately reveal her full intent. But we see her impact on the Jewish world in so many ways, not only in the land of Israel, but also in the overall legacy of the Jewish people as a whole. I want to thank you very much for your intention and your endurance tonight, and I hope you have a fantastic week. Next week, we're going to come back to speak about another somewhat more tragic figure from the Spanish and Portuguese experience. Thank you.
Stand clear of the closing doors, please.